Today's video was supposed to be about this system right here, which I built back in December and has a bit of a saga, a bit of a story behind it, but that's gonna need to wait till a little bit later. Because of some of the issues and delays with this system, I am wedging in a quick probing Paul video. This is actually my second for April, but this is typically a monthly Q&A series, and I'm gonna start with a very important question. What is the best bang for the graphics card you can buy right now?
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by Micro Center. This is one of my favorite places to buy PC parts. So if you're building or upgrading your PC, I highly recommend making your way down to one of their 25 retail stores in the US. They have consistently competitive prices and an excellent selection of PC hardware and other tech goodies. And they have a custom PC builder on the Micro Center website. Use it to spec out your rig and it will show you parts in store at your nearest location while ensuring compatibility. Then you can pick up in store or have their pros assemble it for you. So click the sponsor link in the description to find a Micro Center near you. As usual, a few notes before we get into the probing. There is a Probing Paul playlist if you'd like to go back and reference all of the previous times I've been probed. And I typically pull the questions from last month's video, but since this is sort of a double up for April, I posted this to Twitter and asked for some responses over there. And our first question comes from The Circling. Hi Paul, given all the furor over GPU VRAM and the latest AAA games, what would you say is the current best bang for the buck GPU at the moment for 1440p, or should we just wait for the next gen? So if you haven't been keeping up with this, a lot of this furor recently is regarding slightly older graphics cards, particularly RTX 30 series graphics cards, even more particularly the RTX 3070, which has an 8GB VRAM buffer, which was questioned back when the card launched in 2020. Will that 8GB VRAM buffer hold up, especially as new titles come out and people play at higher resolutions and using newer technology like ray tracing? Some of the most popular videos on this topic recently have come from our friends over at Hardware Unboxed. There was this one right here, 8 gigs of VRAM versus 16 gigs of VRAM. And then Steve did another follow-up testing the 16 gig A4000 versus the 8 gig RTX 3070. And it is absolutely true. In games where the amount of VRAM that's needed exceeds what is available from your graphics card, it can tank your frame rates pretty quickly. A lot of people have asked if this was intentional, if Nvidia sort of saddled these graphics cards with lower VRAM allocations from the get-go because they knew in 2 or 3 years that would become a limiting factor and that would encourage people to upgrade. And is that true? I really have no idea. I couldn't say one way or another. I could see it going that way from the cynical viewpoint of a company that's trying to do some planned obsolescence for their product to encourage sales in the future. But I could also see it being more of a business decision based on the games that existed in 2020 and the typical VRAM that they required, as well as other manufacturing and logistics issues that typical gamers might not consider, such as what is the availability of GDDR6 or GDDR6X VRAM, and would doubling that amount or adding more to the graphics card increase the cost to a certain point where it would get them out of the price range that they're aiming for. But yeah, like I said, who knows? Maybe they had the best of intentions and the best of plans for the VRAM allocation that they did with the 3070. Maybe it was a big conspiracy to get us to spend more on graphics cards. I'm gonna focus on the other part of your question, which is what is the best bang for your buck graphics card, especially for 1440 gaming right now? And my answer is this one right here. The 6950 XT, which used to go for well over $1,000, has now dropped in price and dropped in price and dropped in price until we can see if we're looking at PC Part Picker. And I'm actually looking not just at the 6950 XT, but other RX 6800 and 6900 class cards. And do note the memory allocation on every single one of these is 16 gigabytes. And that will provide you with just a little bit more peace of mind, especially if you have plans to game with the latest AAA titles, such as Hogwarts Legacy, and you want to play at a higher resolution like 1440 or 4K. So $450 for an RX 6800 is a pretty good price, but it's only a $70 bump to get yourself up to a 6800 XT, which is currently going for $520 at the cheapest. But then from there, the next step up is not the 6900 XT. Those are actually going for $620. It's the 6950 XT, available at Newegg for $600. And that's not even like with a mail-in rebate or a promo code or anything. You can just buy it for that much, add to cart. And sure, you may or may not be in love with ASRock's design for this particular card. It's about the performance, and ASRock didn't design the GPU, nor did they set up the memory allocation for this card. I'm not claiming that it is the best 6950 XT on the market, but it does have 7 reviews, 5 out of 5 eggs in all reviews so far. And pretty much in every metric except for power draw, but everywhere else, at $600, the 6950 XT will absolutely destroy the RTX 4070, with the possible exception of specific ray tracing tasks. But considering the premium that NVIDIA has stuck to the RTX class cards, ray tracing being part of that RTX suite of effects. I don't think anyone would be blamed for saying, you know what, I'm okay with not really having ray tracing performance, or having at least some level of ray tracing performance that's not peak for right now, and trading that for $500 to $1,000 of price, because again, 6950 XT at $600 is also $1,000 at least cheaper than the RTX 4090. So that is my advice for right now, and we can move on to our second question. This is actually a double up one regarding an issue that has been talked about a lot this week. It only started to crop up towards the end of last week, and I will be covering this in a little bit more depth on tech news, which will go up on Sunday. But co-professor AB and James Sequence of Numbers are concerned about their AM5 CPUs. 7900 is what co-professor has. James has a 7800X3D, and he's concerned about turning his Expo profile back on. And they are specifically referencing the damage or burnout that's been occurring with a select number of AM5 CPUs, initially reported with the X3D CPUs, but it also seems to be happening with a select number of non-X3D CPUs too. My advice for right now, for anyone who's concerned about this, is to keep a level head and to wait just a little bit longer, because this has only been coming up in the past week or so, and there's a lot of speculation going on online, which is often the case when a hardware issue pops up like this. Like, look at what happened with the 12VH power connector on the RTX 40 series graphics cards. That was massive drama for several months. And we're really only about a week into the investigations of this issue. AMD has made a preliminary statement, at least just a day or two ago. And even though they might not be saying a lot here directly, the fact that they are addressing it and saying that we are aware is good news. It means they're going to be investigating it. And it also means that the, again, small number of people who are affected by this issue are going to be able to get support one way or another. Of course, no one wants to have their CPU burn up, especially with a newly built system. It is frustrating, it is time consuming to wait around for replacements. And so I do not at all want to diminish anyone who has had their CPU burn out. But along with statements from AMD, we also have some statements from ASUS via tech marketing representative JJ. And I believe here on the AMD subreddit Megathread, they also have some information. MSI also made a statement about this. Early reports are indicating that this has to do with SoC voltages. AMD's response also seems to point in that direction. There are still outstanding issues though, like AMD and the official responses have mostly been referring to the X3D CPUs, although there have been reported incidents with non-X3D CPUs as well. A lot of motherboard manufacturers are pushing BIOS updates for their AM5 motherboards, MSI, Gigabyte, ASUS, ASRock, and BioStar. So my prediction, what is ultimately going to happen with all this is they're going to suss out the problem, and it seems like it does have to do with SoC voltages being too high. It is likely almost 100% a power issue with the CPU. So there are likely going to be BIOS or UEFI updates that are pushed out that solve this problem. Whether these initial BIOS updates that are getting pushed out are going to be the end-all solution is probably not the case. We're probably going to need to wait at least a few weeks before this all gets sorted out to the point where everyone can say, look, get this BIOS update or newer and this won't be an issue anymore. But for anyone like Code Professor AB who is on a non-X3D CPU, I would say exercise caution for now, but note that while there have been some reports of burnouts with the non-X3D CPUs, most of these have cropped up with the new X3D CPUs. I would say particularly for anyone who has been running on an AM5 platform for an extended period of time already, you're probably just fine. If it's been working up till now, it's probably going to keep working. You should probably update your UEFI eventually, and I would say run a monitoring application such as Hardware Info just to make sure none of your temperatures that are being reported are getting too out of line. And for James or anyone else who did just recently buy an X3D CPU or who is interested in plugging in those Expo settings, I would say hold off on that for now just as a precaution. Your system will still work with your memory running at the default setting versus the Expo settings. It's just you won't be getting optimal performance out of them. But without further information and investigation, that's about all the advice that I feel comfortable giving you guys right now. Remember, it's only happening in a limited number of instances. Run some monitoring software so you can track your hardware and make sure it's not overheating. And wait and see for those promised UEFI or BIOS updates to roll out so you can patch your system up and give yourself some more peace of mind. Also in the meantime, I would recommend avoiding any BIOS or UEFI that's labeled as an alpha or a beta for now. And like I said, I'll be following up with some more information in tech news on Sunday, so stay tuned for that as well. Moving on to our next question from Mikkel. How hard is it to give away or take apart builds that you find beautiful or perfect? I thought this was a good question, especially since I have this build right next to me, which I built 4+ months ago back in December, and which is a giveaway system and has actually already been given away. But fortunately, the giveaway winner for this system has been very patient, as I've asked them to wait multiple times so I could do one thing or the other. Now we're finally getting to the point where I need to ship it to them. But again, follow-up video on this will likely be up next week. But to answer the question, giving away a system like this one here, I do not find difficult at all. I have a thing where I feel like PC hardware should be used. And even though I have lots of PC hardware that sits around here, it doesn't get used. Whenever I give away a system, that's the thought in my head, is this nice system is gonna go to someone who's gonna use it to play games and do lots of other stuff. And hopefully it will be a blessing and a benefit to the winner, and that makes me happy. I also am blessed to have access to lots of different PC hardware. So even though I love this system and it's drool worthy and it looks great, I am fairly confident that this will not be my last chance to play with hardware like this. So I have that going for me as well. For taking builds apart, I also don't get too nostalgic or anything like that, with the possible exception of a few specific builds. Like, I would say Arctic Panther is one of the ones that is still assembled. It's in my garage at home. And taking that one apart will be challenging for me, for one, because I need to disassemble a custom water cooling loop, and for two, because it's just a system that I've built and rebuilt many times, and also gotten a lot of use out of, and it was in the background of my set for a long time. So yes, there is some nostalgia there. The hardest part for me of giving away a system is actually all the stuff that happens after the video goes up and after the giveaway is live, which is following up and picking a winner afterwards, and then doing the final stuff to get the system ready to go, packed up and shipped. But that's really just a time issue, because that takes away more time from me after the video has gone live and everything, and I'm always short on time. Another question from Jason Whitmer. Every creator loves to talk about how great AMD GPUs are. Hey, I just did that with the 6950 XT, but I'd say only 1% of them actually daily drive an AMD GPU on their personal or even business systems. Is it simply because creators get everything for free and can pick the best of the best? Apparently Linus answered this question recently, and he only talked about the CPU, didn't even mention the GPU. So here, look, I can do that too. The two CPUs that I use in my daily driver systems, this one here at the office and my editing system at home, are both Threadripper systems, because I am a longtime fan of high-end desktop systems that have lots of cores and threads and lots of power to throw at stuff like rendering video. So the 2970WX24 core in here, as you can see, is getting 13% utilization as I record this video. But if I shamefully scroll down over here, you can see that I'm also using an RTX 3070 Ti, which I believe was a card that I just dropped in this system because I needed a graphics card, and that was the easiest one for me to grab and throw in there. To get back to your accusations of glaring hypocrisy though, I will say you're absolutely correct. I often use lots of NVIDIA RTX, GTX graphics cards, and while I do use AMD Radeon graphics cards a pretty fair amount as well, I will say it is true that I haven't really had them as daily drivers in my production systems or my gaming systems much. My excuse, since I feel like I need to give an excuse, is CUDA, NVIDIA's CUDA platform, and how that has been tied into the Adobe video editing software for quite some time. And in fact, if you go back many years to a time when you basically had to pay like $1,000 or a few thousand dollars for a professional workstation graphics card to get acceleration with a video editing program in order for your GPU to help with the heavy lifting with a video editing suite, the addition of NVIDIA CUDA-enabled graphics cards to that suite was absolutely great for me. And there was a time period even when you had to go in and edit a text file and sort of add like an approved NVIDIA graphics card to it. But then as long as it was a CUDA card, it would just work. And yes, things have changed a lot since then, and there are different video editing suites and different hardware solutions, but that is still the one that I am tied to for now. And so that is the route I've gone for production systems, because I know it's not just gonna help for gaming, but it's also gonna help for my video editing tasks. And also, yes, it does help that I get those graphics cards sampled for free. But for what it's worth, when I'm making honest recommendations for people who are just gonna be gaming and want the best bang for their buck, I have hopefully done a reasonable job of pointing out the AMD Radeon deals that are also out there. All right, let's finish out these questions. Perry, AKA Tank of Jank, says, what piece of advice were you given that triggered a re-evaluation of your life? And the thing that popped into my head was some advice that I heard, I don't know, a year or two back, which was, don't take criticism from someone you wouldn't take advice from. And as someone who posts videos on YouTube, I get lots of criticism that comes in from time to time, because, you know, people in the comments tend to be a bit open when they want to let you know that they're not happy with something. And actually, going back to my earlier career making videos on the internet back when I was at Newegg, I actually found it a little bit easier to let that stuff sort of go, because my stance at the time was, you know, they're probably just negative and hateful people and they just want to spread their negativity somewhere, and I don't want to let that affect me. And perhaps over time, I got a little bit more sensitive to it, but I'd say this was just one of those things that I heard in the past year or two that sort of stuck with me, and I like it because it's not just good basic advice, but it's also like a response. If someone comes up and is criticizing you directly, and you just don't think it's valid or don't really place any weight on what they're saying, you can answer with this too. You can just say, well, fortunately, I don't take criticism from people I don't take advice from. Then you turn around and walk away. And then everyone cheers. Next, we have a doubleheader question from a couple of friends of mine, MB67. Mike asks, what do you consider to be the most difficult part of building a PC? The most difficult part is filming. Filming that entire build process adds a lot of complexity and a lot of time to the PC building process. And then my friend Travis asks, how is your family holding up lately, as well as the pups? And thank you for thinking about me, Travis. We've been thinking about you a lot as well. And on the subject of Travis, for any of you guys who participated in the Travis fundraiser that we did last month, many, many thanks to you guys one more time. I would say the family's holding up pretty well at this point. Actually, that's a very comforting part of my life. And it's one of the things where if I'm frustrated with how things are going elsewise, when I get to that time, like later in the day or in the afternoon, when I go and pick up my daughter and we just get to spend daddy-daughter time or the time we've been spending on the weekends, that's really been like my solace and my recharging time. And the thing that I very much look forward to. Nori is our corgi dog is 12 years old now, so she's getting a little older. She's a little more creaky, but along with that family time, we've been able to walk her a little bit more consistently lately, and I think she's been enjoying that, although she has been a little bit sore. And then Hiro, of course, passed away in May last year. We're coming up on the 1 year anniversary of that, and while I still am very sad about Hiro's passing, it's Google that really keeps, like, do you guys have Google Photos or like the Android Photos on your phone, and then it pops up and it's like, hey, remember this memory or whatever? It keeps being like, look at these pictures of Hiro, like every few weeks. And I'm like, how do you tell Android that your dog passed away and to not tug at your heartstrings when you wake up in the morning? But anyway, thank you, Travis and Mike, for those questions. Next we have Felipe, Metalman GG. Not really a question, more of a thank you. Your recent step-by-step building guides have given me the confidence to build my first system this coming weekend, so thank you very much for your work. Felipe, I am very happy about that. I hope your build goes really well. And absolutely, for anyone who might have missed them recently, or for anyone who has a friend, a relative, anyone who they are trying to get into PC building, my How to Build a PC series is going to be a four-part series. Part four should be up next week. Part one covers learning all the parts of the PC, the seven main components. Part two is a basic $900 budget build guide meant for beginners. It covers all the basics. And then just a couple days ago, I posted my high-end build guide, which is meant for people building systems that cost $3,000 and up. That's gonna integrate more complex things like RGB lighting with a bunch of fans or an all-in-one liquid cooler. But I've tried to make those videos very thorough and very accessible, especially for beginners who are just getting into PC building for the first time, because that goes all the way back to my earliest history doing videos on YouTube when I used to work at Newegg. I always felt like I got the most fulfillment and the best feedback from the tutorial videos, because there'd just be so many people who are like, I couldn't do this, and then I watched a video, and now I can, and I did, and that always makes me feel good. So, if any of you happen to be going to LTX, which is later in the summer, I do plan to be there. So if any of you come up to me and talk to me and you want to tell me that you watch my tutorial video and then use that to build a PC, that's one of the greatest things that I like hearing at events like that. But I hope you guys have enjoyed hearing some of my answers to today's questions. This has been Probing Paul, episode number 78. Closing reminders to check out my store at paulshardware.net. You can find shirts, mugs, pint glasses, beer sets, and more there. Great way to help support my channel while getting yourself some excellent merchandise at the same time. If you enjoyed this video and you want to hit the thumbs up button, that's great too. And of course, if you'd like to subscribe to my channel, that's a great way to hear about whenever I post new content. Thanks again for watching, guys, and we'll see you all in the next video.